We begin in Africa 300,000 years ago, around the time humans first diverged from their close relatives. See, at this time, several hominid or human-like species roamed the continent and beyond. The first to leave Africa were probably Homo erectus. By the time our story starts, erectus had been dispersed across Europe and Asia, as far as Indonesia, for almost 2 million years. During this long period of separation, erectus diversified into several semi-distinct species, likely including Neanderthals and Denisovans. Back to our direct ancestors, though. 300,000 years ago, anatomically modern humans existed in Africa, physically, but not mentally or culturally. Distinct cognitive developments arose around 70 to 50,000 years ago, providing the building blocks of language, art, religion, and culture. Maybe not coincidentally, this is when modern humans first made sustained moves outside of Africa, likely crossing by way of the Sinai Peninsula or hopping over to Arabia. From here, humans quickly spread across Europe and Asia, even reaching Australia by 42,000 years ago, at the latest. None of this is settled science, so don't get too attached to any specific number. When thinking of these migrations, go ahead and forget the world geography you're familiar with. Sea levels were much lower due to huge ice caps concentrating water at the poles and in the glaciers. It was an ice age. Thanks to these lower sea levels, a person could walk from Thailand to the islands of Borneo or Java. And nearby, the Australian continent was connected to New Guinea in a great landmass called Sahul. Asia and North America were periodically connected through a land bridge called Beringia. Paleolithic. The first phase of prehistory, stretching from the emergence of modern humans to the end of the last ice age, is called the Paleolithic. It comprises a huge majority of human prehistory and is characterized by the use of larger stone tools along with bone and wood. As mentioned earlier, cognitively modern humans did not arise until around 50,000 years ago, and this marks the third and last phase of the Paleolithic, from around 50,000 to around 12,000 years ago. During this time, humans were scarce on the Earth. There were fewer than 30,000 people in all of Europe during the Paleolithic. They lived in small bands at this time, and without farming, large areas were needed to sustain even the small population. All people were transitory nomads, moving from place to place to follow game. Despite this, these people were capable of incredible art. In a cave in southern France, astonishingly lifelike drawings of animals have been found. At other sites, exquisite and stylized human-shaped ivory carvings have been found all across Europe. Mesolithic. The transition from Paleolithic to Mesolithic, meaning Middle Stone Age, took place in Europe with the end of the last ice age, about 12,000 years ago. This Middle Stone Age marks the culmination of hunter-gatherer lifestyles prior to agriculture or animal husbandry's development. Mesolithic people had advanced the technology of their Paleolithic predecessors in a number of ways. Their stone tools were generally smaller and more intricate and elegant. Mesolithic people also began to make and use early forms of pottery and textiles. Their food gathering methods had also shifted. Mass hunting of large animals was now less common. Instead, they employed broader strategies for food gathering. Permanent structures, absent from the Paleolithic, began to be constructed. These were most commonly along coastal areas and were likely used only seasonally. Without agriculture or livestock, areas are quickly depleted of food resources. The Mesolithic ends with the development of agriculture, but Mesolithic hunter-gatherer lifestyles continued in places unsuitable for agriculture throughout the Neolithic and up into recorded history, right alongside Neolithic farmers and herders. These original inhabitants of Europe form one of three components of DNA of modern Europeans, the hunter-gatherers. Neolithic. The Neolithic began with the development of agriculture and animal husbandry. This process began in the Middle East in the Fertile Crescent, the fertile area curving from Israel, Palestine, Lebanon, and Syria down the floodplains of the Euphrates and Tigris rivers. The development of farming was not a sudden process, where society went from being migratory hunter-gatherers to sedentary farmers in a single generation. Wild grains had been collected and eaten for eons by Paleolithic and Mesolithic peoples. At some point, people may have begun to plant some of the grains they collected, untended, and left alone while they left for a season, only to return and harvest them. Over time, people began to select for grains with favorable qualities. This slow process of domestication rolled on for probably thousands of years. True agriculture began at the end of the last ice age in the Middle East. The process just mentioned had been in place here for millennia alongside other hunting and gathering, but the end of the ice age brought climatic shifts, which made other food resources more scarce. To survive, these people began to lean more and more heavily on harvested grain. A feedback loop started where more grain could be harvested when better tended and cared for, but this took time away from other hunting and gathering, so they had to rely more on their harvest grains, etc., over and over. Alongside the domestication of grains was the domestication of animals for livestock. First, wild boar were domesticated around 11,000 years ago, followed by sheep and other animals soon after. Agriculture began first in the Fertile Crescent of the Middle East, but this is not the only place agriculture arose. Following the last ice age, agriculture arose independently in several places across the world. Next, after the Middle East, were the fertile valleys of the Yangtze and Yellow Rivers of China. Soon after, agriculture was developed in Papua New Guinea, followed by Central America, South America, and Sub-Saharan Africa, each location having its own collection of several crops. Lifestyles for these Neolithic people were now vastly different from their Mesolithic ancestors and neighbors. They lived stationary lives, spending their days working the fields. With stationary food sources came permanent dwellings, and populations and settlements grew throughout the Neolithic. Cities began to grow, and food surpluses allowed specialization. These cities were isolated islands of urbanism in a wide sea of hunter-gatherers. Agriculture led to surpluses of food. This, along with a stationary lifestyle, allowed an increase in the birth rate. Populations began to grow, and for a little while were sustained by the larger yields of a particular area and total calories offered by agriculture compared to hunting and gathering. But these growing populations soon led to conflict. These early farmers, seeking new lands not yet claimed by settled people, began to migrate out of the Fertile Crescent. One group of farmers entered Anatolia, modern Turkey, and by 6500 BC, they had reached Greece and the Balkans. From here, it seems these early farmers split and went in two directions. One group moving along the Mediterranean, the other group expanding through the Balkans to Central Europe. Together, these Neolithic people are called early European farmers. These farmers form the second group which contributed to modern European DNA. The first group were the hunter-gatherers. When the farmers migrated into Europe, the land was not empty. Hunter-gatherers were still thriving in their Mesolithic lifestyles. At first, the archaeological and genetic record show little interaction between the two groups. The farmers preferred open, inland areas with solid, fertile soil, while the hunter-gatherers preferred the woodlands, wetlands, and coastlines where reliable plant and animal foods could be found. Because of their separate lifestyles, and perhaps some type of religious or cultural taboo, there was little intermixing or interbreeding between the two groups. Nevertheless, the two groups lived side by side for around 2,000 years, each maintaining their own way of life. Over the course of this time, though, early European farmers would have constituted a larger and larger proportion of the total population of the area. Then, about 4000 BC, the status quo crumbled. Although we don't know why, a sudden resurgence of hunter-gatherers occurred. Their share of the gene pool suddenly rises, implying some kind of violent takeover occurred across much of Europe. With this resurgence, the two societies that had lived separate but side by side for so long began to meld together. The violent population turnovers weren't over, though. Beginning about 3000 BC and intensifying over the next millennia, a new society rushed onto the European stage. These were the steppe nomads, the Yamnaya, the Proto-Indo-Europeans, and they make up the third portion of modern European DNA. The language you're listening to this in is descended from these people, and today, more than 3 billion people across the world speak a language descended from the Proto-Indo-Europeans. So how did this small group of nomads come to dominate the world? The answer lies in their violent society and in their early adoption of the wagon and bronze weapons, all of which aided their conquests. The arrival of the Indo-Europeans was a tectonic disruption in populations, especially extreme among males. The Indo-Europeans brought about nearly total male replacement in their migrations. Bands of young Indo-European men would raid into unsuspecting farming communities, killing the men, gathering up food, livestock, or valuables, and taking the women. It would have been a horrible time to be a farmer there. Sometimes it was more than raids, though. They would come and kill the leaders of the farming communities and place themselves as the head of society. By becoming the elites in every land they conquered, the populations under their rule began to speak their languages: Latin, Greek, German, Celtic, Hindi, Russian, and Farsi all share their origins in the migrations of the Indo-Europeans. Let's look away from this bloodbath and check in on the Fertile Crescent. The farmers who stayed behind were not stagnant. In these fertile lands, societies became increasingly complex and true civilization took root. Nearby in Egypt, the climate began to change following the end of the Ice Age. The Sahara, which for millennia had been a fertile grassland, began to become desert. The nomadic people who had made their homes in the Green Sahara migrated to escape the spreading sands. Many of these refugees gathered around the fertile land along the Nile River. In their new environment, many took up farming. First, there were many small states dotted along the Nile, but soon conflict led to consolidation until only two remained, an upper kingdom in the south and a lower kingdom in the north. Around 3000 BC, the king of the upper kingdom conquered the lower kingdom and united all of Egypt under one pharaoh. Thus began the first dynasty of the Old Kingdom of Egypt. At the time of the unification of Egypt, back in the Fertile Crescent, civilization was already old. Cities began appearing in the north of Mesopotamia, the fertile region between the Euphrates and Tigris rivers, and slowly crept their way south into the wetter regions nearer the Persian Gulf. Around 5400 BC, a people we call the Sumerians began to prosper in the south of Mesopotamia. They spoke a language separate from the people around them, who mostly spoke Semitic languages related to modern Arabic, Hebrew, or Syriac. It's not clear exactly where they came from, and they weren't a united people, but were spread across several city-states, like Ur, Uruk, or Eridu, much like the Greeks of the Classical Age or the Italians of the Renaissance. What sets the Sumerians apart from all their predecessors is that they were the first people in all the world that we know of to record their lives in writing. Around 3500 BC, someone had the idea to record information symbolically. Taking their fingernail or a stick, he or she etched a picture on some wet clay to record something. At first, the symbols were purely pictorial. The symbol for a fish looked like a fish, and the one for an ox looked like an ox. Over the next few hundred years, though, as the idea caught on and spread among traders and tax collectors, the symbols were increasingly simplified. By 2900 BC, Sumerian scribes had begun to use a wedge-tipped stylus to make the symbols. With the first writing, prehistory comes to an end. The rest is history. Thanks for watching. This is the first prologue episode of a history series covering Western history, whatever that means, from the year 1 AD to the present day, with one episode per decade. These prologue episodes will help cover our bases before we get to 1 AD. For more, you can tune into the 202 Decades of Western History podcast. I'll see you next time.